I want to stick with stocks now and bring in Brian Levitt. He is global market strategist at Invesco. Brian, good to see you. So, I mean, I think we've got the buy the dip mentality at play here today, certainly in the tech sector. What do you make of the action we're seeing today, this bounce back, and do you think it's going to last?
Yeah, so what I make of this whole thing is that there's the irony that in year one of a market recovery, everybody doubts it and says, how can this be happening if the economy isn't good? And then in year two, everybody struggles to assess whether it's just gotten too good too fast and it's too hot. And so the last few days have been that latter story, markets being disrupted by concerns of inflation and higher rates and premature Fed tightening. And today's a little bit of a reprieve on that story as rates come down a bit and investors can start thinking about longer duration assets again. And can it last? Look, it's going to be a debate all year, this idea of inflation and higher rates and Fed tightening. And so, you know, that could put some challenges into the market, particularly longer duration assets. But ultimately, I wouldn't sleep on growth stocks, and I expect the structural growth companies to continue to be the long-term winners here.
You mentioned inflation in there, Brian, and I know that you say you're not worried about inflation. I got news for you. That puts you in the minority because it looks like the broader market is pretty concerned about rising inflation, especially with the fact that we have this stimulus package now coming in, which will probably just fuel the fire there. Why are you not as concerned as the rest of the market when it comes to inflation?
It's the greatest debate I think I've ever seen in my career. It's amazing to see the two camps form around this. It's not that I don't think that there's going to be inflationary pressures in the near term. I mean, we know that inflation is too much money chasing too few goods. And so what ends up happening in the near term as more people get vaccinated and the pent-up demand gets put into the system, there's going to be a lot of money. We know that. The question is, how quickly can we ramp up the economy and re-engage the labor force in order to match that demand? We've got probably 10 million un or underemployed Americans. So you can start to increase hiring in order to match that demand, but it's going to take some time to get all the workers back. And in that time, you're going to see some pricing pressure. My point is to say that that's likely to fade as you move into 2022 for a variety of reasons. Again, the economy is running below capacity right now. We have workers that we can bring back on. And for all the concerns about the fiscal deal, it fades in 2022. I would view the fiscal deal largely as income replacement for the hardest hit Americans, and then that fades in 2022. So it's not as if we don't get some inflationary pressures. It's that inflationary pressures start to fade into next year.
You sound a lot like Fed Chair Powell when you say things like that, right? Because he called inflation transitory. During that Wall Street Journal Jobs Summit. So, do you think the Fed should respond to the rise in pricing pressures and higher inflation at all? Because the Fed didn't talk about reducing asset purchases, seems still ready to keep rates low for longer. Should the Fed be trying to get ahead of the curve?
No, I think it's still premature. I mean, this is an economy that's well below trend. It's very heightened unemployment. We're still trying to recover, getting back to where we otherwise would have been had we not had the demand destruction that we experienced in 2020. So the Federal Reserve is working to support and promote price stability and full employment. We're nowhere near full employment. Look, if they think that price stability is becoming an issue, then they will use the tools at their disposal to address it. But for now, they think it's too early. I agree with them. The velocity of money is about as weak as we've ever seen in our nation's history. So before we start assuming that this is all inflationary and the Fed changes their tone, we should at least see some of this money start to circulate through the economy. And it's simply not happening yet.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Brian, what's your take on what we're seeing in the bond market right now? I mean, I know that yields are starting to pull back a little bit. Do you think that we're going to continue to see that trend, or is this just sort of the quiet before the storm?
I don't know if I would call it a storm. There's probably a pause that's taking place here. Cyclically, rates are likely to head higher. I mean, again, it's an economy that's going to gather momentum as the year progresses, as more Americans are vaccinated, and there's some inflationary pressure to be brought into the market and the economy. And that would portend higher rates. The question is, how concerned should investors be about it? Remember, coming into the year, coming into 2020, interest rates were 182, and that was a very weak, benign inflation environment. And now we're all concerned at rates at 155. So I think we're overstating it. It's a reversion that needed to take place. Rates were very overbought. We've had an appropriate sell-off. There's some cyclical support for rates to continue to trend higher. My point is to say that structurally, rates are going to continue to remain low. And they're going to continue to remain low because it's going to continue to be a slow growth world once we move beyond this recovery period.
So you think there's going to be this big boom? I mean, the OECD is predicting growth of 5.6% this year, 4% next year. Do you think 4% is even too optimistic for next year?
Yeah, it might be a bit optimistic, largely because a lot of the fiscal support starts to fade. But remember, when we look at these numbers, think of the basis effect. I mean, we're coming off of a disastrous period, a worse economic outcome than what we saw during the global financial crisis. And you know, last year, I spent the entire year trying to convince everyone that a recovery would take hold. And that it was okay for markets to be going higher because markets are forecasting better economic activity and better earnings growth. And now it's the exact opposite. Now we're trying to remind people that we didn't go from a period of demand destruction and massive inflation, massive deflationary forces to a period of outsized growth and massive inflation in a few months period. The answer lies very much in the middle of those two extremes.
All right, Brian Levitt, global market strategist at Invesco. Thanks for being with us today.